Hey, good evening, and welcome to the first NCO Development Town Hall hosted by the U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command. My name is Master Sergeant Mike Levine, and I'm a Big Red One soldier from the 1st Infantry Division. This town hall is an event created just for you, the U.S. Army soldier. Tonight, you're going to hear from some of the Army's top enlisted leaders and experts discuss some of the major changes underway with NCO development. Now, I'll introduce them in just a moment, but our great panel includes Command Sergeants Major from TRADOC, the Army Reserve, National Guard, and even the Sergeant Major of the Army will stop in and join the conversation. We have experts from TRADOC's Institute for Noncommissioned Officer Professional Development standing by to engage with you in our chat rooms and on social media. But first, let's go over a couple of housekeeping items before we begin our discussion. There's two ways for you to participate in tonight's discussion. First, you can use the chat box, which is located right next to the video player on the live streaming page. Make sure you click on the rules of engagement before you log in to see how that works. Second, you can provide your perspectives and ask questions using the hashtag #TalkToTRADOC, that's the number two, #TalkToTRADOC on social media. We'll have experts from the Institute for NCO Professional Development engaging with you on the chat board, Facebook, and Twitter. So make sure you follow and like TRADOC on all those different outlets so you don't miss anything. Well, that's how you can join in on the discussion, so be sure to also click on the schedule so you know the order of tonight's events. Well, in terms of questions that you can ask, nobody on this panel has seen the questions beforehand. And as great questions come in, we'll take them right off of social media and the chat board directly to the table here, courtesy of our army of helpers in the background. We just ask that you keep your questions professional, but don't pull any punches. Now, before I introduce our great panel members, let's check out a great video about NCO 2020.
Is anybody listening?
Here we go again. More redundant training isn't realistic.
I can't stand SSD. It's not user-friendly and just more check-the-block training that makes it too easy for people to cheat.
My time is spent being killed by PowerPoint and trying to get ALMS to work, let alone being an NCO for my guys.
My deployment kept me from taking care of PMA and getting to school. Now I'm way behind.
When I get out, how am I going to get a job? Who's got a clue what I did in the Army?
I've been in this position for 2 years already. Why do I have to take this course now?
Just teach us to think, to solve problems, to lead.
Is anybody listening?
There is no doubt that you, the Non-Commissioned Officer Corps, are the backbone of the U.S. Army. After years of war and focusing on the fight, the Army is prepared to make revolutionary changes to prepare you for the challenges of an uncertain future. TRADOC is fundamentally revamping the NCO education system into a development system whose end result is innovative and adaptive soldiers who can solve problems, fight, and lead in a complex world. These changes affect you, driven by extensive research, but more importantly, your voice and feedback. This new development system will require broadening your horizons, broadening your knowledge, and broadening your experiences. You've often heard that to get ahead in life, you need a better education. The time has come for your career in the Army to do just that. It used to be that deployments and other reasons created a backlog, nearly 14,000 enlisted soldiers who needed to go to school. Thousands were 4 to 6 years behind in their class time. Not anymore. The Army has developed the STEP program, Select, Train, Educate, and Promote, and requires all soldiers to attend their appropriate level of professional military education in order to be promoted. Your abilities in written and oral communication will be emphasized, because a complex world demands clearer thoughts and clearer words more than ever. And with Army University, every soldier will have the opportunity to earn a college degree and receive credentials that certify their knowledge and skills with industry standards. In addition to stressing the importance of education, your development system will use state-of-the-art teaching techniques and technology to deliver realistic training and lessons learned from combat. And to guide your educational journey, the Army Career Tracker and its career maps will show you exactly the path you need for advancement. Those paths will provide you with more broadening opportunities, not only throughout the Army, but also with leading industries and governmental agencies, making you that most desired leader and citizen. And when you complete your career with the Army, all your training and skill testing will compete in the outside world more effectively than at any time in American history. So here's the bottom line. We'll deliver the training and resources in creative ways. You do the work. You'll be a better NCO. We'll be a better Army. Okay, so now's a great time for you to start posting your questions to the chat board and to social media. And I'm not being rude. If you see me checking the phone, that's where our questions are coming in through social media here on the iPhone. We're going to post those answers both to social media and present them to the panel here. Speaking of which, let me introduce them now. Starting off is the Command Sergeant Major of U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command, Command Sergeant Major David Davenport. Next up is Dr. Aubrey Butts, the Director of the Institute for Noncommissioned Officer Professional Development. Sergeant Major Annette Weber, the G1 and G4 Sergeant Major at the U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command. Command Sergeant Major Brunk Conley, the Command Sergeant Major of the Army National Guard. And Sergeant Major Jim Wills, Command Sergeant Major of the Army Reserve. Sergeant Major, the floor is yours.
Well, thanks. Well, first I want to begin by thanking everyone for taking the time out, wherever you may be, to join us for this important discussion on the new non-commissioned officer professional development system. Now, I am here to admit Duffel Blog was correct in their reporting yesterday that nothing was going to prevent me from having this conversation with you all on how we plan to develop, talent manage, and remain the stewards of our profession as both soldiers and non-commissioned officers with the various initiatives that we have planned. I'll be the first to admit we are changing a lot, and we're changing it quickly, not only with NCO PDS, but with NCO evaluations, proposed MRD changes, and with enlisted talent management. All that change can lead to friction, anger, and fear of the future. Tonight, I hope that we can have a great conversation on how to make sense of all this change for the future of our non-commissioned officer corps, some of which you may agree with and some you may not, but I think it's worth to have that conversation. For as a senior leader in our Army, I think it's my job to put things into context so that you better understand what we're doing, so that you can visualize the future, what the future of the non-commissioned officer professional development system will look like. I think we may get a question or two about STEP during the discussion, but STEP is only one part of NCO PDS. STEP gets our soldiers into our great schools at our centers of excellence that teach them the core competencies of their particular MOS so that they can go back to their teams, their squads, and their platoons to lead and train soldiers as they prepare for the next deployment that will be in a complex environment. That means we have to have facilities conducive for learning. We have to have the proper equipment. We have to have POIs that are relevant, quality instructors, and administer tests that support the exponential learning model. We also have to develop a manner in which to record that great training and identify those soldiers, those non-commissioned officers, that exceed core standards. And that's why we're working on the AER, or the Academic Evaluation Report, and the DA Form 1059. All of these initiatives are total Army. That's why I've asked my good friend Sergeant Major Conley from the National Guard Bureau and Sergeant Major Wills from the Army Reserve component to join us in this important conversation. So I am here with my team, and like the opening video said, we're ready to listen, provide answers to your questions, and hopefully we'll pick up a couple of good recommendations for some things that we've overlooked. So with that, I have my pen, I have paper, I'm ready to go.
Right on. Well, let's get after it, Sergeant Major. We are going to take questions for about the next 45 minutes, then we'll take a short break and hear from the Sergeant Major of the Army. Our first question tonight comes to us through social media from a soldier from the Strike Brigade of the 101st Airborne Division. Sergeant Wilson.
I'm Sergeant Joseph Wilson from 2nd Brigade Combat Team, 101st Airborne Division, Command Sergeant Major. With the new STEP program, a soldier has a certain time frame to attend the corresponding NCOES upon promotion. For smaller career fields that offer ALC a few times a year, this creates a backlog of highly qualified NCOs and hinders their progression. Is there any plan in the future to fix this?
Sergeant Major, backlog, it's one of the biggest questions out there. The perfect panel to talk about that.
Yeah, well, I agree. And Sergeant Wilson, I think your question really gets at capacity. Do we have the capacity to train? And we do have that capacity. But when you go in and look at the allocation of school seats, and especially, as you indicated, in low-density MOSs, we have to make sure that we are spreading those seats across the year so that soldiers have the opportunity to attend those seats, schools. And really, to kind of highlight that would be if, say, that we had 100 seats for your particular MOS for ALC, and we only teach that course twice a year, that's probably 50 students in a classroom. So maybe we offer that course five times a year with 20 or something along those lines to make sure that there's opportunity to attend training.
I think it also gets back to communicating, Sergeant Major. I think that as a soldier, soldiers have to communicate with their branches, their leaders, and get their thoughts out there and known so that we can get them into those schools that they need to go to.
Well, it's also got to be the capacity issue. It cannot just be an active duty issue. Mm-hmm. Sergeant Major Conley, I've got to figure that it's an issue as well in the Guard.
Well, yeah, the especially in low-density MOSs, especially multiple-phase courses, it's very challenging for our soldiers that have a three-phase course to get selected to go to those schools, and then they have to wait 3 years to go in two-week increments to get those done. One of the things my Command Sergeant Major Advisory Council in the National Guard is looking at is if a soldier shows good faith and attends phase one of a course, we're looking at adjusting the policy that we could promote them upon completion of phase one conditionally, that they've shown good faith, they've gone to school, they've met height and weight, they've met PT, and we promote them pending completion of the follow-on courses. And if they don't complete, then that promotion would be taken away. But it starts the clock on time and service, time and grade. And if they've shown the effort to finish the first phase, I think we need to look at that.
But what you're saying right now, just to be clear, this is pre-decisional. This is something
it is pre-decisional
in the works.
Yeah, we need to look at it. And the other part of that is it's very hard in our low-density MOSs because they can't leave their job, leave their employment for 6 weeks, 7 weeks, 8 weeks at a time. It does have to be done in increments.
Well, what I was going to say is this is just a indicates how both the components are incorporating STEP into their promotion policy. And the concept is the same, but the way that it's being administered is slightly different in each component. So we're only in the second month of this, and I think we're learning as we go along. And kind of going back to Sergeant Wilson's video question, we're also leveraging the great schools that they both have in order to up that capacity. So if we don't have an opportunity to train a soldier in PME, we look into the other two components and see if there's opportunity to get them to train.
Sure. Sergeant Major Wills, how's the Army Reserve getting after the capacity issue?
Yeah, so thanks for the question. And just to let you know, our biggest challenge, I think, is making sure that our training NCOs in the unit really understand the process as far as the TRAP process of how we allocate the quotas. To your earlier question, though, funding is tied to, our quota allocation. So we really are doing very well this year as far as our overall execution rate. I don't think there's going to be any issue with us being able to fund all of our requirements this year. And the key thing is for our training NCOs and our first sergeants to convey that process of understanding the order merit list. And the other thing of, and Sergeant Major Davenport, I think, nailed it, that we're going to have to work together and probably look at some of the challenges we've had in the past where we'll look at the size of the classes and the makeup and that thing as far as ISR. In student-to-instructor ratio, so that way we can conduct more frequent classes and allow more opportunity, especially for the Guard and the Reserve, to be able to do that summertime requirement, as a school teacher or whatever the case may be.
Sure. Well, we're going to jump ahead. We're talking about what some of the requirements for institutional training. Let's jump ahead to what life may be like after the Army. So a question from the chat board coming at us from ForceCom. Could you please tell us more about TRADOCs and the U.S. Army's credentialing initiatives as part of Soldier for Life? So Dr. Butts, credentialing, certainly an issue that has a lot of people's attention, because with the right credential, that's your added, you're moving the decimal point to the right on salary requirements after you get out of the Army.
When Sergeant Major Davenport first came, he looked at how much we were paying for soldiers that were getting out of the Army. And as you know, the Army, they pay their unemployment costs, which was about $750 million a year. And from there, we instituted Army University. Army University will serve two purposes. The first purpose is to look at the soldier's skills, the jobs that he do, and connect those to a credentialing process. In addition, to take their military education and hopefully at the end of a 3 or 4 year career, if they only take 5 more classes, they will be able to walk out with an associate's degree.
Wow. So with that in mind, there have to be other opportunities in our Reserve and National Guard parts of the team for credentialing. I understand the Reserve is actively working a program right now.
Yeah, we've got a great program with our private-public partnership initiatives, and right now we're currently working with General Electric, GE, to send our soldiers after they've completed their AIT to it's kind of a fellowship or internship, if you will. So once they've graduated that, so they're actually fully certified to be able to go out and be an X-ray technician in the civilian, in the private sector. You know, so, and with that, it also will provide a lot of these individuals to be able to go back to work for GE and some of those larger companies. So that's just one initiative, one company. We're actually partnering with a lot of universities and partners across the nation, really. So we're pretty excited about this opportunity.
Well, it's funny, we mentioned Army University. A question coming in off of Twitter. Andrew Schick is asking, is Army U and its degree programs accredited? And by whom, and if not, when are these expected?
Well, right now, Army University is an accreditive. However, we're going to use the joint transcript to record all their experience and education. And for probably a pretty good reason, we want the soldier to be able to get a degree from the college they want a degree from. But schools like College of the American Soldier, they're taking the experience of the soldier and the education and agreements from right now about 76 different universities, and they combine them together to be able to get the degree that they want from the institution they want. And Sergeant Major.
Well, Army University, if there's any cohort that benefits from the Army University concept, is the Noncommissioned Officer cohort. Because what Army U does for us is it takes, like Dr. Butts was saying, our education and our experience of leading soldiers, and it puts it in terms that academia can understand. It translates into college credits. Another powerful thing that Army University does for us, as POIs now are developed and they come to the Army U for validation, we have a team that will look through it, analyze it to make sure it's meeting ACE standards so that we can get as much education equivalency as we can for that soldier attending that classroom. And then it will feed into that transcript Dr. Butts is talking about, along with credentialing. And so I think that's the power of the way forward, is to recognize our great institutions, our schools. They are accredited. They're accredited through our QAO program to make sure it's meeting the intent that we need. You heard Sergeant Major talk about instructor ratio. All of that, it goes into play when you're providing quality education. So I'm very excited about the direction that Army U is going to help get some energy, some synchronization to NCO PME.
Great.
So, Major, I want to add to that, too. So from previous discussion, from our understanding is tuition assistance also, it's kind of spreading a little thin. So by the fact that we will get credit for a lot of the things that the soldiers are doing now, It'll allow them to spread tuition assistance a little further as we go forward. This is a positive for the soldiers across the compos.
Yeah, we just hope that a lot of soldiers take advantage of that, because a lot of soldiers don't know. So as we educate soldiers and their leaders, and hopefully, again, everyone takes advantage of it. It's a great opportunity.
And I think that's one of the great things of the career map, you know, that was just instituted, that we are having a path that a soldier could follow. And if they follow that path, they hit all the courses that they need, and it takes them through their military experience, the credentialing, as well as their civil education.
Well, I don't want to stifle any of the discussion here at all, but I'm being told right now through the earpiece that this is really heating up. We're getting a ton of questions through the chat board and a number of hits through our hashtag. So let's move on to the next question. This is coming off the chat board. And unfortunately, if you don't put a name down, I'm going to read what they show me. So guest 4246 wants to know, how does the Army reconcile the fact that broadening assignments such as drill sergeant and recruiter have a little role in being selected for promotion during centralized selection boards, yet soldiers had to say no when DA selected them for assignment? So where I think this question is going is based from a board document from the center from the office of the Chief of Infantry that looked at this last Master Sergeant board that said the NCOs who were more favorably considered at that time were at the rifle company level, mm-hmm. and those who were in recruiter and drill sergeant positions were not viewed as favorably.
Well, I mean, of course, that's something that is dependent on the particular CMF, because that particular CMF decides board guidance and what's important to grow that sergeant or that staff sergeant into a sergeant first class or sergeant first class into a master sergeant. And, of course, every year we look at board guidance, and as conditions change, priorities can kindly change. And so no one doubts the fact of the value of leading soldiers in combat, but drill sergeant and recruiter duty has equal value as well to the other proponents. So as we move in this period of transition, I think that that soldier will see that drill sergeant and recruiter will have value in future boards.
Yeah, and the proponencies are actually updating their message to the board, so that information will get to the board members, because all those jobs are very important jobs to the different CMFs.
But it is safe to say that it's weighted differently, though.
By CMFs, because they have a view of what they think makes a successful master sergeant, whatever. Right. Grade that we were talking about, and the proponents write that guidance, because they're told their select rate is only so many positions. So sure. As they write that guidance, they want to make sure that the panel has a clear message of what they need, mm-hmm. Not rather than what they want.
Right. It's important too for Compo 3, for the Army Reserve soldiers, to understand that it's not a healthy thing for their career to understand that once they go out into that broadening assignment, they need to go in, do their time, and move on to another opportunity. We have a lot of folks who want to kind of homestead an opportunity they don't want to get out of it. So it's key that they understand this. It's good and it's healthy to move from O&F to the generating force to get into a training assignment.
Well, and what Dr. Butts brought up about their career maps, I think we should kind of elaborate on. And first of all, we saw an example of it in the opening video. The new career maps really operate across five lines of effort. Of course, the first line of effort is experience. Those jobs that we think non-commissioned officers should have in order to grow, team leader to squad leader to platoon sergeant. The second line of effort is education, more than just PME and SSDs, but really start to have that conversation about working on our civilian education. The third line of effort is broadening, as the question brought up, and really changing the definition that we have used in enlisted cohort for so long, special duty assignments, drill sergeant, recruiter, AIT, platoon sergeant. Now you will see things like that on there, but also training with industry, fellowships. So it's just more than those drill sergeant recruiter that has you to be brought or helps you to become broadened. The fourth line of effort, as we talked about with Dr. Butts, credentialing. The proponents are telling the force, hey, if you're in this particular CMF, this is what's this civilian credential is important for you to be able to do your job, or civilian equivalency to doing your job, and that helps with transition to Dr. Butts's point. And then, of course, the fifth line is JPME, and Joint Professional Military Education. Starting it off at staff sergeant level, it will be distance learning in the beginning. We're going to leverage already two courses, senior enlisted JPME 1 and senior enlisted JPME 2, to really start stressing the fact that if the Army is going to be the foundation of the joint force in the Army operating concept, then our non-commissioned officer corps, which is the backbone of that Army, needs to have an understanding of JPME. So each one of those proponents, I've just looked at the draft of all of them this week, as a matter of fact, have listed what they consider important to them, and they will develop their board guidance based off that career map. And then all that comes back up to TRADOC. We validate it, and then it goes to HRC for board purposes.
Great. Well, let's take another one off the chat board. This one is coming from guest 1688. Why don't enlisted personnel require a degree, especially at the senior NCO level? Military courses are too short to even offer college credit. The level in which they are offered is insulting. When will our standards be raised to compete professionally against civilians? So again, that comes back to Army University and what our professional experience can offer in terms of academic credit.
Well, first of all, you know, I want to say the Army and its NCOs serve one purpose, to go to war and win in a complex environment. However, you know, if you look, a lot of the courses they do receive credit for, but because if you look at the life cycle of a soldier, you know, it's pretty short compared to everything else that they have to do. So, therefore, we can't afford to send a soldier to school for 3 or 4 years. So that's where the structure of self-development come in.
Well, Dr. Butts, can I ask a question here? Because is this really partly about managing expectations for soldiers and saying, hey, you went to a 6-week course. Are you expecting 3 college credits out of this course?
It is. However, if you look at most NCOESs, they will walk away with credits for those courses. And what we're doing, we are structuring the structure of self-development so when they go through there, they will receive credit as well.
Well, and let me just kind of jump in on this. First of all, there's no requirement for us to produce college degrees in the institutional domain. I think it's important to understand that there's really 3 domains that produces a leader. There's the institution domain, which is everyone around this table, TRADOC, and then there's the operational domain or the organizations, and then it's the soldier in the self-development domain. And if that member would want to get a civilian education, we will help them. As I tried to explain in an earlier conversation about leveraging ACE, the Army U, or the JST transcript to make sure that we maximize college credit, the experiences and education that we provide it for them. And then they can leverage a program, the College American Soldier, SOCAD, or choosing a university at their leisure. But I agree with Dr. Butts. We cannot lose sight that our Noncommissioned Officer Professional Education is about certifying leaders in their core competencies that go out and train and lead our soldiers in combat.
Well, taking it back to the chat board here, asking a question, VFM001, asking about the new course we're hearing a lot about, the Master Leader course. How will MLC be implemented? Is it residence, online, or MTT? And we're throwing it right back to you, Dr. Butts. What is the plan for this course? What's the path ahead for the rollout?
Well, to answer this question, it's going to be more or less in some form or another, all 3. However, we're trying to get it residency and MTT. And, you know, Sergeant Major, if you could help me out on how we're going to implement this.
Yeah, so what is happening is we've gone through a pilot at Fort Bliss. We've done an iteration at Camp Williams, Utah. Mm-hmm. Our National Guard hosted that. And in, I believe, next week.
Next week, yes.
Fort Knox at Sergeant Major Will's RTI will host the second pilot of, pilot of the MLC course. Getting a lot of positive comments back about the rigor, and quite honestly, some of the soldiers said that's the first time they've ever gone to PME and really felt challenged, because you don't have an instructor up there telling you what to think. They're trying to teach you how to think, how to do critical analyzing a situation. So MLC, and it's not the first sergeant course, if I can get that plug in there. We think that stuff kind of resides in the operational domain. And this course is really designed to start making those senior non-commissioned officers aware of the transition from the tactical level of our Army to the operational, and giving them a glimpse into the strategic level of our Army. And Dr. Butts is exactly right. We will do it brick and mortar. We have the ability for MTT, and then we would do a distance learning just for the reasons I think we talked about earlier for our Guard and Reserve, to make sure they're not penalized, because STEP applies to everybody. Mm-hmm. It's just not staff sergeants and sergeant first classes. If you want to become a master sergeant, our gap analysis said that you need to be certified in those core competencies before you move forward. And it also applies to our non-commissioned officers, senior non-commissioned officers, the senior sergeants major who are selected to work for a general officer or compete to work for a general officer. When they're selected by the board, they will be required to attend formal education called the Executive Leader Course, our new level 6, before that they can go work for that general officer. So STEP applies to everybody. STEP applies to all components. And Master Leader Course is to cover that gap that we didn't have prior for the master sergeant.
Okay. So we're gonna switch gears a little bit here and go to another video question that was submitted through social media using our hashtag. That hashtag again is #TalkToTRADOC, #TalkWith2TRADOC, and this is coming from Camp Buren, Kuwait.
Sergeant Major, my name is Sergeant First Class Caleb Berrio. I'm the Public Affairs NCOIC at one of the Army's largest multinational training centers here in Europe. I've had the pleasure of teaching and mentoring many soldiers and NCOs from units all across the United States that come here to train and work during these major training exercises. There's been a common issue that we've kind of tossed around each time they come and talk with me. And quite honestly, I really agree with what they're bringing up. My question to you is this. With all the educational distance learning systems out there that our soldiers are using to get their civilian degrees with, what is TRADOC doing to update or improve the SSD courses so that they're more interactive and valuable as a tool, so that our soldiers are completing their institutional training requirements? Thank you.
Sergeant Major.
Well, right after STEP, the second most question I get asked is about SSDs, and quite honestly, the comments are it's not to standard, and I would tell you I somewhat agree. And so what we've done is we've formed a working group down at United States Army Sergeant Major Academy, and have begun a review of SSD 1 all the way up to level 6, because every PME will have an SSD. We think that we want to make sure that the SSD prepares the soldier to come to school. And then the experience in the school is tied to the next SSD to kind of give a glimpse of what's coming up. So rather than just dumping things in there without any rigor to what it's tied to. I've heard from the force. They want some type of academic grade to come as a result of this, rather than just a go or no go, and they want it to count for something. So we're working on that. The another comment that's come from the force is that if a soldier doesn't understand or just tries to check the block, lock them out. and we're working on that as well. So if you don't understand the task, you fail to meet a standard, you'll get locked out for a period of time until you're non-commissioned officers or you get retrained and to come back in and try to accomplish the SSD. So I understand the concern about SSDs, but we don't have enough time in the classroom. I don't think there's ever enough time in the classroom, and so we have to leverage these SSDs to get at what we need them to do rather than being filled up with stuff we don't.
Well, I'm pretty sure that that is not the last time we'll hear about SSD during this panel discussion. So back out to the chat board, our discussion at the very beginning about the backlog in professional military education has caused a sort of a follow-up here. This is coming from guest 9202. In reference to the U.S. Army Reserve PME backlog, is there any way to prioritize funding to bring reserve instructor, contractor instructor, and open building that have open buildings that have closed to get slots open? And I throw that to you, Sergeant Major Wills.
Yeah, so first of all, that, you know, the process how we do this is done through the training resource arbitration panel, through the TRAP process. So, you know, for us to be able to go out and do an MTT is not a problem. It's the fact that it has to be something that's programmed in advance. So within the current execution year, we typically won't do an MTT unless we are requested by TRADOC actually to do the MTT for, let's say, a deploying unit or something like that. So for us to really consider the PME backlog piece of it, I think it's really the key understanding that, number one, units have to make sure they project what their shortfalls are, what their issues are far enough out when we're going to the into the TRAP process so we can project those training seats and build appropriate classes where needed at the right time. So that's really the key part here for us to be able to send instructors out for an MTT. We can do that as long as we know, and there's nothing that prevents a unit if they have, I guess, the student density to come up on the net and request that we won't consider to be able to support that. The things that they have to take into consideration, though, is whether or not we have the equipment and the facility is there to be able to meet the requirements within the POI and safety and things like that.
Sergeant Major Conley, that's got to be a concern for you as well.
It is. Again, we have 54 entities that we send training dollars out to those organizations. And it kind of depends where they're at in the SRM cycle on what their needs are. And it's just like Sergeant Major Will said, we have to do a detailed analysis about efficiency, cost effectiveness, training requirements, equipment, and instructors available to do that to stand those courses up. It's not a capacity problem. All right. We recently got briefed that we have 17,000 requirements and 35,000 available seats to meet those requirements. It's a matter of being efficient with the dollars we do have and make sure that we execute those to the best of our abilities. And then when we have gaps, we have to do the analysis to say, how are we going to reallocate resources to fill those gaps?
I'd like to add to you that one of the things that, you know, we get this question all the time about the shortfall of seats. And when we go in and we check, you know, the numbers, we typically find out our overall average execution rate for the Army Reserve has been around 67% of our quotas throughout any 12-month year.
Sure.
So, and then, you know, what we also find out is that, you know, just because when the training NCO goes in today to put in an ATAS application into ATARS, and it appears that there's no seats available, you know, among the compos, you know, we have folks at the USARC and NGB level who can pick up the phone and call the other component and say, hey, you know, you may have 60 quotas of, let's say, 12 Romeo. Are you really going to use them because we're down to the wire? And, oh, by the way, we can ask to exchange quotas to be able to work through these things. It's just a matter of communicating the process.
Sure.
Well, you know, we saw that today at our schools update that the three of us sat through. We meet monthly and go over capacity, see if there's any issues, and we saw exactly what Sergeant Major was saying. And to reinforce Sergeant Major Conley's point, we have capacity. I think we need to talk about the backlog because STEP has caused a huge impact on the backlog. Just in first quarter numbers, we've seen that backlog from over 14,000 come down about 4,000, and that's really the result of STEP, the force understanding the direction that we're moving in, and understanding that PME is going to be a requirement is important, and they're getting out to the schools. The ones that I have concern about are the ones that are no-shows, that has a valid seat, has a reservation, and just doesn't turn show up to course. That is a huge problem. That's how we lose the capacity to train somebody. And that's where we could, I think all of us could use the help out in the force, is to make sure that when your soldier gets a date to attend school, PME especially, they're ready to go. They're fit, they've had their pre-execution checklist done, and they're ready to train.
Sir Major, I don't want to beat this one to death, but the thing is we keep talking about how STEP and certain things have created the backlog. What I want to be careful with is that the soldiers understand that the backlog was really created by the soldiers who have refused to go to school for the last 2, 3, 4 years. So, you know, where we've got, especially in Compo 2 and 3, I don't know how much it is so much in the Compo 1 of the active duty side, but, you know, those soldiers who have not done exactly what you said as far as meeting the fitness requirements, being able to pass the PT test and go to school, and they've just tried to wait the system out, if they will, you know, there's the point of injustice. So I need those soldiers, we need those soldiers across the compos to understand, hey, we need you to get on board, we need you to get in shape, get ready, and let's get everybody in the school, and eventually this backlog will kind of weed its way out, and we'll get through this.
I do want to beat the dead horse.
Okay. All right. Go, Brunk.
All right. I think the most important thing I'm going to say tonight is in the Guard and Reserve, everything that happens at the company and detachment level. If it doesn't happen there, it just doesn't happen.
That's right.
So first sergeants and detachment sergeants, you have got to put all your efforts into making a no BS order of merit list and train your readiness NCO, get with your company commander and make sure that he agrees with that OML. And you've got to execute that OML right down the line. And readiness NCOs have to have a backup plan if some unexpected circumstances happen with the number one soldier that you're getting ready to go to school, you got to go down number two. Now, one thing the soldiers need to know is not going to be all the, like, let's just take BLC. Just because you're a sergeant and you've been promoted does not mean you're going to be number one on the OML. If you haven't gone for a period of time and you haven't shown that you can meet height and weight and PT standards, a specialist or a corporal is going to be on the OML higher than you if they're ready to go, because that makes our dollars be spent efficiently and we have less waste and we will get at the backlog over time. When STEP is implemented, we will not create one more backlog National Guard soldier from January 1st forward.
That's right.
And we have 60,000 soldiers in the backlog for NCOPDS. That number will attrit over time as soldiers go to school, ETS, clear a medical review board, all right, or retire. And so that number, it will take us a while to get there, but to reiterate, first sergeants, readiness NCOs have got to make sure that OML is executed.
Or selected for some type of separation, like for being lack of PME qualified.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. That's right. I hope our Army Reserve soldiers are listening, because what you just said is not specific to the Guard only. It's applicable across the board. So I appreciate that comment, Sergeant Major.
Well, and the part about, as you said, the no BS OML, that's one of the concerns that came to us on Facebook. This is from Elena Rooney. She says, BRAG BLC is so backed up. My soldier recently passed the board, but will have to wait months to attend because E5s who haven't attended have highest priority. It screws over my soldier because he can't get promoted without this school. So really, it's up to the unit level to determine the E5 who hasn't been to school for 2 years, 3 years, may not necessarily or should not necessarily be the first one in the chute over a motivated E4 who has completed the board requirement.
Yeah, but and I think it's Ellen. What we get Ellen to understand is that she is only looking at Fort Bragg. I mean, we have to think about the total Army. Price. We have opportunity to train BLC in both the Reserve and National Guard. It's the same POI, same certified instructors, and the same outcomes. Their NCOAs produce just as good non-commissioned officers as the active component.
Excellent. Well, we're going to take it back to the chat board here. Coming from Master Sergeant Lucas, 125, in reference to broadening assignments with the Guard, we have a problem called a Title 10, Title 32 swap. How can we get those swaps to be evaluated on the same level as a recruiter or drill sergeant? Now, I want to widen the aperture a little bit here about broadening assignments, because it isn't just, we don't want to just address this with our total Army partners. This is a total team concept. Broadening is a huge part of our development, Sergeant
Absolutely.
Major.
I mean, I got an opportunity to go to a broadening type assignment, a fellowship. You know, when, and again, I did not want to go, you know, some soldiers don't want to go and take that opportunity to go. But I say that, you know what, your leaders know to ensure that they can get you to those things. I know that for me, I went kicking and screaming, but it paid off. It was a benefit for me. There's a lot of opportunities out there, and we just got to get smart on those opportunities. And so I hope leaders, you know, we got to educate ourselves first, and then so that we can educate our soldiers.
But it's also talent management, too.
Absolutely.
It's picking the right people.
Absolutely. And there goes to make sure that we counsel soldiers correctly, make sure that things get in their record, so that when, you know, your managers are looking for someone to go into that talent management jobs or that broadening type opportunities, your fellowships, you know, it's there, it's stated, so that, you know, we don't have a problem with selecting the best of the best.
Now, to swing it back to the Guard and Reserve, one of the questions, I'm in a fairly small career management field, and at our ALC and SLC, they brief the broadening opportunities like advanced civil schooling, training with industry, and it gets the entire class excited, and then they drop the other shoe. Sorry, Guard and Reserve cannot participate in this because of the Title 10, Title 32.
Well, I see a change coming in that, but I need to go back to Master Sergeant Lucas's question, all right? There has not been one Title 10, 32 swap request that's been denied, all right? The problem is, now that's typically an AGR full-time issue, is that finding applicants that want to do the swap. We've executed everyone that's come up to my level, and it's a negotiation between me and the state's Army major and finding the right skill sets to be able to do that. Now, to incentivize that, then that's board instructions. The board should say, just like Sergeant Major Davenport said before, a Title 10 32 swap should be looked at favorably. If you're even with the peer and you have a swap and they don't, that should give you total soldier, you know, looking at the total soldier concept, an edge to be a little bit higher on the promotion board. Now, so I hope that answers Master Sergeant Lucas's question, and he'll get with his state CSM and we can work on his particular issue.
Sure.
Would you refresh me on the question you asked? Broadening assignments.
Right. Well, opportunities like training with industry, advanced civil schooling, the things that someone would have to come active.
Those are opening up, all right? Those are opening up. The more of the announcements I see now are just say soldiers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right? And then we have a leader development pool, a pot of money that NGB has pulled back. And I see General Anderson in the G3, and when these things come out, the aperture's open up to let all soldiers apply for those based on their knowledge, skills, and attributes. If a soldier is selected, as those opportunities become more available, there will be funding to allow those guardsmen to be able to participate in those programs.
Well, if I can give some supporting fire here, I think both components competed in the recent USASMA fellowship, where we're going to select 20 sergeants major to attend University of Pennsylvania to get a master's degree in education and then teach at USASMA for 2 years. So I agree with Sergeant Major, just so the force knows, that's just not a talking point. It's actually happening. And so I think it will get better over time.
Mm-hmm. And probably SMA will be mad. Penn State.
Oh, Penn State. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Penn State. Yeah.
It's the lights.
Yeah, it does that to you a little bit. Taking to Twitter now for a couple of questions. It's pretty much the same question. Mr. White and guest 7549 are both asking questions about the Army Physical Fitness Test. Mr. White on Twitter says, will APFT standards be the same for male and female soldiers with gender integration into combat MOS? And then guest 7549 is asking, why aren't females being graded the same as males on the APFT?
Okay, everybody's looking at me. I'll take that one. Okay, well, first of all, the DODI, the Department of Defense Instruction, says that that we are to grade APFT by gender and age. So that's one thing. That's a requirement that we have. I think what the force is really getting at is the OPAT, the Occupational Physical Assessment test that we are out now gaining data. And what that's going to be is the physical assessment along with the cognitive assessment of ASVAB to help civilians choose or recruits choose the jobs to serve our Army with. So that's OPAT. And then we're looking at how do we certify, maintain that proficiency, and something similar called the Combat Readiness Test, the CRT. And then we will get into the APFT, because what we have to think through is scale. We can't do the, I think it was called the ACRT, where we had this one plan we were going to try to do, but we just couldn't get it to scale. Right now, the PT test is pretty efficient. It's you, the ground, and a stopwatch. And so we have to figure out what the future requirements are going to be. We finished up the physical demands survey with 2 years of looking at what tasks we're going to be required as we integrate our combat MOSs. All the commandants are working in the physical high demands task into their POIs, their graduation requirements. So I think that we're kind of mixing apples and oranges here. We will make sure that everybody is physically fit to do their required job in our Army. That's what makes our Army strong. And then we will talk about individual fitness with APFT as we move forward.
Okay. Well, we're going to take another one off of social media. And this is coming off of Twitter from Christopher Ellisor. And he's asking, can we have a system, and we're back to STEP, can we have a system where motivated staff sergeants can attend the senior leader course without being promotable? I've been trying for a couple of years.
Okay, well, so granted. And that's the beauty of FRAGO 1 to the base order of the Noncommissioned Officer Professional Development System. We established three priorities of to get into PME. Priority number one was those affected by STEP. So if you go to the board or you select it after 1 January, you will be priority number one. Priority number two are those soldiers that was in the legacy backlog. And as the two great sergeant majors have pointed out, over time that will trid out. But if they have had 36 months or more in grade, they have received their scheduled PME to get out of that backlog. The third priority are what we're calling the train ahead population, because we realized as we looked at this that there were going to be either soldiers surpassing standards that units wanted to get them to school to put them in positions of increased responsibility. And we understand that missions will pop up, whether it's a RAF or a real world deployment, and that we could get soldiers in to train ahead so that we don't have a promotion backlog. So it is already in place. It's a simple 4187 process through the chain of command to HRC NCOS branch, Mr. Bailey. And when there's capacity not being used, they will get slotted against that course.
But unfortunately, it doesn't address the no-shows, because capacity it'll show is a full class, but day zero report date.
Yeah,
it's kind of a crapshoot.
Yeah, so again, that's a great point of the impact that no-shows can have. So you have a soldier surpassing standards, impressing the chain of command. They want to get him or her ahead of their peers, but can't because they can't get them into school because someone had a slot and didn't show up.
Okay, well, we're gonna take a break very shortly, but I want to throw one last question out there, and I don't want to necessarily stir the pot too hard, but I'm going to stir it just a little bit. So as all of us as NCOs and retired NCOs around the table know, there's kind of been an us and them culture with our officers sometimes.
When you look at how officers are educated, how they receive their professional military education, they get a PCS move. A deployment is not going to stop an officer necessarily from CGSC or from War College or something like that. And the point is brought up by one of the folks on the chat board right now, guest 7388. Officers are afforded better and more effective schooling opportunities. Why are we not allowing our NCOs the same opportunities to better themselves and lead?
Well, I mean, that's a little vague, but I'll take the first stab at it. First of all, a lot of things that govern the officers are in law, and most enlisted stuff are in policy. So I differ, and that might be because I'm where I sit. I think that both officers, non-commissioned officers, warrant officers, and our great DA civilians get quality training in TRADOC.
But now, not to interrupt you, but you hit the nail on the head, and that's something that not a lot of people know, the difference between law and policy. Mm-hmm. So policy is something that can relatively easily be changed, mm-hmm, if the impetus is put behind it. Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to throw you off there.
No, you didn't. I just think that the expectation is that our task in PME is to produce college education. It's not. Our task, again, is to certify non-commissioned officers in their core competencies in order to that they can go back and lead and train their soldiers for what our Army will ask them to do next. That's how you build readiness. Okay, that's how we build readiness, is through leader development. One of the ways is through leader development. And I just don't think that I really understand the scope of it, but PME is PME. That's another powerful thing of Army University. All four cohorts are represented, the warrant officer, the officer, the enlisted, and our civilians. And we come together and figure out how mission command is synced all through those cohorts and at every different level. So without a little bit more detail, that's kind of how I took that question.
And there are opportunities out there with broadening opportunities. I got an opportunity to meet a young E5 who had an opportunity to go to school, and she was a 68 medical MOS, where she got an opportunity to go and get a degree and then come back and serve in the Army. So there are some opportunities out there that soldiers can go and come back. Again, get your education, come back and give back to the Army.
Well, there's actually three different programs, if they'll log on to the blog site, that we laid out in great detail about civilian education. Mm-hmm. So if the force wants to know more about those three programs, it's TRADOC News, all one word, .org, straight from the sergeant major, and you'll see education opportunities, I think, mm-hmm, is the subject of the blog.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, but I'd like to kind of jump on this and call it what it is. But, I mean, you know, the truth is our NCO Corps has provided more opportunity of education today than ever in history. So if we look at the culminating opportunities and experiences, and oh, by the way, look at how much credit we're now giving for just the experience of being a squad leader, a platoon sergeant, what have you throughout, or those broadening, mm-hmm, assignments. Because, you know, one of the challenges we have is soldiers jumping into IG assignments or EO assignments, and they not to realize what that will provide to them, you know, as college credit or otherwise. So, you know, the thing is, our NCOs have got to get back to the fact of understanding that while we want them to be educated, and I would probably throw a plug in there to say that on the guard and the reserve side, a lot of our guys have master's degrees and bachelor's degrees, and they're out there, you know, dealing with this stuff. But we really need these guys to become technical soldiers at their skill, at their craft, at the enlisted soldier level, so they can be able to go and deploy, do their job in theater, and come home alive. That's really what we need to get these guys focused on. So I appreciate that question, though. So.
And I really think that we need to concentrate on making them trainers, because I think over the last 14 years, yeah, we have lost our ability to train. You know, that everything was contracted out. So our young NCOs, they don't have the ability to take a young soldier that's straight off the street and say, these are the things that you need to know, and I'm here to teach you. You know, they'll wait until someone else. But in a complex environment, we can't do that anymore. And we're gearing the schools that we could give those soldiers those attributes that they need to survive in a combat environment.
That's right.
Absolutely. Well, that's a great first session. Awesome questions. Keep them coming. Remember, on the Facebook page, through Twitter, and in the chat window at tradoc.army.mil/watch. Keep using that hashtag, #talk2tradoc. That's talk with the number 2, TRADOC. We're going to take a short break to allow everyone here to stretch their legs, maybe drink some water, take a knee, and then we'll hear from the Sergeant Major of the Army very soon afterwards. When we return, we're also going to ask the panel why some soldiers feel a set of orders to certain OCONUS locations can put your career on ice. So stick with us. Okay, we've got a special guest visitor who's going to join us for a few short moments. I'd like to welcome the Commanding General of U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command, General David Perkins.
Hey, sir, we've had a great first session, and I appreciate you taking time to come out and talk to the force of your views of what we're doing with PME and the way ahead for the Noncommissioned Officer Corps.
Well, Sergeant Major, thanks for having me here, and I appreciate all the folks that have taking time out of your busy schedule to kind of dial in and be part of the question and answer piece, as well as just become informed as to what's going on. You know, when you take a look at one of the things that TRADOC does for our Army is we design the future of the Army and then we build the Army. And so when we build the Army, we've got to make sure, like you're building a house, you build it on a good foundation. And the foundation that the Army has always built our house on has been our non-commissioned officer corps. It is the envy of the world. It is the one thing that really sets our Army apart from all other armies. All armies have soldiers, they have rifles, they have rucksacks. No other army in the world has a non-commissioned officer corps like the United States Army. And as I travel around the world, and also to our other joint partners, they always ask me, where do you get your non-commissioned officer corps? And what I tell them is, it's homemade. We built it. They are the foundation of the Army. We built the Noncommissioned Officer Corps upon which we build the Army. And so I think the initiatives we have out there that you've spearheaded along with the Sergeant Major of the Army and our other senior noncommissioned officers say, okay, we have this envy of the world, the Noncommissioned Officer Corps, the foundation of our Army. How can we make it better? So things like STEP and then our professional military education that we're putting into this to make sure our non-commissioned officers are well-trained and well-prepared before they go into their job so that they can continue to excel, I think is critical. And so for our soldiers out there and non-commissioned officers, when you see changes coming around in the Army, when you see changes to professional military education, to the NCO a professional development strategy, to STEP, what you need to do is say, you know what? The Army is investing because these are investments, their time, their money, their people, their the intellectual capital. When they see this, don't view it as, hey, the world is changing. I used to be real comfortable with this and now it's changing. I don't like that. That's not the way to view it. What they need to view it as, this is an investment the Army is making. They wouldn't be spending all this time coming up with these new programs. They wouldn't be putting all this money into it unless they thought I was worth it. So they ought to be grateful that the senior Army leaders, our non-commissioned officers and officers, view the non-commissioned officer corps and hold them in such a high regard that they're like, it's worth our time to update how we develop them. It's worth our time to invest in them. And so, again, I think it's just a symbol of how much we realize the uniqueness of our non-commissioned officer corps.
So we're getting a lot of great feedback from the chat boards and Facebook. And I got to get back over there and answer some more questions. So thanks for your time. Thanks
well,
for stopping by.
Thanks, Sergeant Major. And again, thanks to all of you out there with regards to becoming involved and invested in what's going on out here.
Great, sir. Thank you for stopping by and sharing some time with us. Now, we're going to jump into our second Q&A session in just a minute. But first, the Sergeant Major of the Army has a quick update with us.
Hey, team, let me just take a few minutes to add to discussion here. First, I want to start off by thanking TRADOC and Command Sergeant Major Davenport for all the hard work they're doing, not only to advance our non-commissioned officer education and professional development system, but to get the word out through venues like this and through other venues. Second is to tell you the importance of change. I mean, you know, we need to continue to change and adapt our non-commissioned officer professional development system so it is the best in the future, better than any other organization in America and the world. We are not the only Army in the world that has recognized the value of a trained and educated enlisted force, and it is our job to stay ahead of our adversaries, not just with future technology, but also with our training and education. And lastly is to tell you and remind you that you have a responsibility too in your professional development and education. You have the responsibility to let us know how it's going. And forms like this are part of why you should raise your hand and say, hey, here's my concerns. Here's the things that I want to see change. And after we make the changes is to give us feedback, whether positive or negative, on the things that we're doing. Team, appreciate all you're doing out there. Keep up the hard work. Army strong.
SMA, thanks for tagging in. We really appreciate it. Listen, keep plugging away on social media using that hashtag, #talk2TRADOC. That's talk two with the number two, TRADOC. And continue to fill up that chat board. Now, we've got another video question for the team, and this is the one coming from Camp Buren, Kuwait.
Good evening, Sergeant Major. My name is First Sergeant Hall of the HHC Brigade, First Sergeant for the 2nd Brigade Combat Team, 1st Infantry Division, coming to you from Camp Buren, Kuwait, and I am a Big Red One soldier. Command Sergeant Major, within line of effort number two, talent management, how will the Army and branch managers select the most qualified and most deserving for strategic broadening opportunities or even make the senior NCO aware that they qualify for these specific opportunities?
It's a great question.
I happen to notice he's a Big Red One soldier, and you are as well. Well, I think it really goes back to our earlier conversation about that career map.
Sure.
And I think once the soldiers log on to ACT and they see the new format and how they can run their mouse over it or touch screen it, it opens up to the requirements and the description and all the qualifications. How do you reach out to HRC? Who's the point of contact? And then it's a matter of going to their chain of command and saying, hey, I'm interested in this, much like interesting attending PME ahead of time. And then there's already established processes in HRC that will look at the packets and in conversations with the chain of command and the proponency, select the best soldier for that job, much like the process Sergeant Major Weber went through to be selected to work at Department of Labor.
Yeah, let's just ask Sergeant Major that it's important that soldiers update their IPERMs because that's important. That's what drives when HRC goes after looking for the best qualified. So it's important that soldiers get involved with their careers and their records to ensure that that gets updated.
So Sergeant Major Weber, what's the chain of command's role in that talent management process?
You know, the chain of command role is to ensure that, you know, soldiers, you know, do what they need to do. You know, as far as soldiers concerned, I mean, there's mentors out there, so ensure each soldier should actually find a mentor. But a chain of command role is to ensure that soldiers are educated, they're well informed, and they know about the different things that are out there in regard to broadening type assignments.
They're also making sure for those broadening assignments that the right people.
Absolutely.
So it's not just sua sponte, I'm going to apply for this because this sounds cool. They want to make sure that it's the right person for the right position.
And that's where your evaluations are very important. You know, things need to be documented, you know, to ensure that we get the best soldier for those opportunities.
Yeah, and probably I think we'll all agree is that it kind of goes back down to that company level, is holding soldiers accountable to the Army standards. Mm-hmm. When they come into the institutional Army, that is not the time to find out that they can't pass a PT test or overweight. Mm-hmm. So holding soldiers to Army standards is another thing that they could help us with.
Absolutely.
Okay. So we're going to go to Twitter now from Josh Young. How will deployment and dwell time affect promotions? Is it better for a career to deploy or to go to school? And I've seen a great deal of this, particularly in the last 2 years, where brigade combat teams are on a 9-month either an operational rotation to Korea or to Europe, and still the continuing pace of deployments where a soldier may have a ALC or SLC class date that's in the middle. Well, the days of being able to operationally defer them, that's not the new reality. So
well, we still can defer folks. We don't like for that to happen because all that does is move a training issue down the road. And you're exactly right. If in case of a deployment or a RAF mission, that's why we want to use that priority three that I talked about earlier, is to train ahead. Really getting those company level leadership, that battalion level leadership, starting to know their soldiers and get them into schools.
As our guard units continue that deployment pace, Sergeant Major Conley, I would have to think that consideration of stacking school versus the operational requirement is
a big thing too.
It's very challenging. You know, our company commanders, all commanders are tasked with having a ready unit ready to deploy to go and fight and win our nation's wars. So they have to have a very good conversation with their soldiers and make sure that they don't sacrifice readiness. Let me rephrase that. That isn't coming out the way I want it to be. Soldiers need to go to school, all right? There's no NTC rotation that didn't occur because one of our soldiers went to NCOES rather than to the schools. And every time a soldier goes to school, somebody else has to step up and get a higher level of responsibility and training in order, and they become a better soldier by taking on those leadership responsibilities. But the company commanders, they have a hard decision to make there. And we ask them to sit down with soldiers, communicate with that. I think we can do both. But it really takes, shoot, move, and communicate. The first one to always go down the tubes is communicate. So you just got to keep talking, and work your way through that. Every problem has a solution. You got to find a way to do that. And we know our, currently under the current situation, it could change tomorrow, but we know what units are on the patch chart to get going, and we know that 3, 4, 5 years out, and we got to be progressive planners and be strategic out there and put our resources to get those soldiers to school. You can do both. It's just hard. Nobody said it's easy.
Well, we're going to switch gears here and talk about an issue that has been several years in the making, dating back to about 2007 when drill sergeants took their hats off in the advanced individual training environment and became AIT platoon sergeants. Two questions now coming from the chat board. Why don't AIT platoon sergeants get the same permanent badge recognition that drill sergeants receive? And then another question, do we plan to bring drill sergeants back into the AIT environment? Now, Sergeant Major Davenport, there is a little bit of a, I don't want to call it badge envy, because that's the wrong way to put it, but certainly it does seem that the drill sergeant gets a little bit more recognition, SDAP, they get a little bit more brought to the table than the AIT platoon sergeant.
So in that period of time that you, you're spot on about to remove drill sergeants from the AIT was to recognize that period of transformation or that they were going through. So less total control and a little bit more, non-commissioned officer, recognizing the role of the non-commissioned officer. And no time were we meant to for hats, badges, or belts. And over time, because of that envy, we started doing different things, whether it was trying to go after a hat or go after a belt or a badge. And so currently what we're doing to get at the second question is that we are moving forward with putting drill sergeants back into the AIT training environment. It's a recommendation. Of course, we have to see about funding. But we're trying to do everything that we can to make sure our soldiers are successful when they transition to their first unit of assignment. And we lose about 12% in the training base of the cohort that we get. And we want to make sure that they're the fittest, the most disciplined, and well-trained soldiers that we have as we give them to their first unit of assignment. It's not that AIT platoon sergeants are not doing that. It's just a way to invest in the training of our soldiers.
Wow, so that's sort of almost breaking news right there, because that's the first I've heard of the return of drill sergeants to AIT.
Well, we've done the cost analysis. We're moving the case forward and to see if it's, first of all, feasible, affordable, and sustainable. And that's anything that we do, you have to look through those filters to affect change.
Absolutely. Okay, well, we're going to head back to social media here and see what's popping. So this one is from Heather O'Weeney, which I really hope I pronounced that name correctly. She says, I separated a year ago. While I was in, I received little to no financial readiness training. Now I'm out, I see veterans buried in preventable debt. Are there plans in the future for financial readiness classes and educating soldiers on available programs? Now, remembering providing some of those classes in the IET environment, day five or day six of basic training, there's a lot of things that go on in that first 2 weeks. Is it fair to say that we might be underusing what we should be in terms of providing that training?
Well, I think as we talk about the complexity of change to our Army, of course, retirement benefits, et cetera, is another thing that's changing. It affects the morale of our soldiers. They do receive training in the IMT or IET environment. And I know that because of all the recent changes, the Center for Initial Military Training, they're looking at what we're providing to our soldiers to make sure that they're informed, they have awareness, to alleviate some of that fear.
Yeah, they are providing that training, and like Sergeant Major stated, basic training, AIT, and then as well when they get to, you know, the BLC as well. And so it goes throughout the soldier's whole career kind of thing. So we're not trying, we understand that soldiers need that development in regard to financial readiness. As a soldier gets out and they go through the Soldier for Life programs as well, there's also financial readiness. So we, you know, every step of the way, there's a piece where young soldiers have to go through to ensure that they're financially ready, or the tools are actually there for them to be financially ready as they get out.
I mean, how often do we say on the board, you know, where would you go get financial help?
Sure.
So take it out from the board and actually do it. Go to the ACS to see the financial readiness liaison and work with them to get the training that they may need or help they may need. I think is the way to go.
So I think this is a good question, but at the end of the day, isn't this again someone looking for an Army-wide solution? That's something that can be handled at the local level.
So let me jump on that. A couple things is, we in the Army Reserve have just done a couple of online seminars. So we've got some of the professional folks out there, some of the big time names, and I don't want to promote anybody, but so they're out there on our social media sites. And for an active duty soldier, a guardsman, mm-hmm. or a reservist, they can click on those links so they're available to them. So we're doing those kinds of things. This was also something that was brought up last Friday during the quality of life panel by one of the congressmen to the SMA in the panel. And I will tell you that the SMA and the senior enlisted jumped on this as a concern, and that we're gonna attack this. I think there's probably some things where we can do better, but. It is being looked at across all the components, and there's initiatives out there that's ongoing. So I think we just got to communicate those.
Also, in the Army Career Tracker, they have a budget maker. And the NDNA, you know, it told us, hey, we really need to do this. However, what we do, we build these great programs. And as I was speaking earlier, you know, it's a leader's responsibility, you know, to look at a soldier and to make sure that they know how to balance a checkbook, that they know how to do a budget. We just can't take them out to the field, train them all day, and then when they get back to garrison, you know, don't believe it's a day after tomorrow. And for everyone, you know, they need to know how to budget and to live within their means.
Do you, Dr. Butts, do you feel that that may be another example of some of those lost skills that we've maybe lost over the last 14 years? I mean, I remember when I came in the Army, I had a team leader and a squad leader that were in every aspect of my life, between, you know, telling me what time to get up and where to go, but also, you know, hey, you're shopping for a car. Are you going down there to shop for a car? Are you, you know, I see you got that brand new cell phone. Can you handle that? Do we want to go back to the days where a leader was in every aspect of your business, or have we moved beyond that?
I think young soldiers have an expectation that you are there mentoring them. And mentoring them is making sure that most aspects of their life, that they learn how to survive. I remember being a young soldier, you know, that just as you said, you know, that I remember I wanted to buy a car, and my squad leader came and said, hey, do you think you can afford the brand new car? And after he sat me down and went through insurance and everything, I couldn't. I got a car, but it wasn't brand new. But now, you know, I thank him, you know, for taking the time to say, okay, don't get yourself overburdened.
Yeah, well, I think, just kind of from an earlier comment, again, I think it's all three domains of leadership. Mm-hmm. It's the institutional Army. We have a responsibility mm-hmm. to make sure soldiers are informed and trained. But the organizational, the operational domain's got to help us out, and the soldier has to help us out. You know, if they are having problems, you know, much like anything, is to get out and seek help. Just we don't want anyone suffering, whether it's financial or other issues. Mm-hmm. Let a non-commissioned officer know so that they can help you.
You know, they also cover this during our Yellow Ribbon events, too. Mm-hmm. So we do have that as one of the listed courses for financial management opportunities, typically when they go to the Yellow Ribbon. So at the different phases they go through, that's also something that's available to them. And there's other opportunities. They can probably grab a hold of Army One Source and things like that and make appointments through that as well. So,
great. Well, we're going to take another question from the chat board. This is coming from guest 952. What does equivalency mean in our NCOES? And if I stagger or stammer my way through this, I apologize. A lot of this is cut and paste. So complete sentences would be appreciated on the chat board. If it means the same standard for AC and RC, and the RC has a hard time meeting the standard of the AC, should the standard be adjusted? I think that's a fair question for Sergeant Major Conley and Sergeant Major Wills. Do we expect the same standard across all three components when it comes to performance in NCOES?
Could you scroll up the question a little bit so I can see the end part of that? Because I want to see the rest of the question if you guys
can. Sure. So it says, should the standard be adjusted? For an example, an approved individual critical task tested in ALC and SLC that results in many RC soldiers failing to meet the standard.
Okay, this is actually I can't tell you how much I disagree with this. I mean, I'm getting fired up because the standard is the standard is the standard.
Right.
Period. End of discussion. There is no AC, RC standard. It's an Army standard. Our soldiers don't want any different standard than anybody else that's going through any course, any training, any event. This doesn't even pass water. The standard is the standard. We want the same for every, you know, it doesn't matter what component you're in.
So what people have to understand, though, is we are entirely resourced differently when mm-hmm. it comes to the educational process. So as far as a critical task site selection board, my experience of any of my soldiers or myself sitting on a critical task site selection board, it's never that we try to dumb down, you know, the elements of training or the lesson plans that are, you know, specific to try to, you know, make it easier for our guys. It's a matter that, you know, we are funded for 15 days of annual training or 15 days of school, basically. So anything above that, we take out of our operational budget to cover the cost for that. So that's really what it comes down to, more of trying to what can we afford within that period of time. So when we're going through critical tasks, everything can't be taught within a certain period of time. The other piece of that is, and I think the equivalency they were talking about there may apply to some of our, especially in our medical field. We got some, you know, our combat medics and things like that. It's across the spectrum that we grant equivalency to the reserve components and the active components, you know, alike. I don't see any differences out there. So if there's something out there, I'd sort of like to know what the specifics are.
Well, some solid opinions here. I can see that. Hey, we're going to jump out to Facebook really fast. And this is kind of an interesting perspective. I don't think it's one that I've heard before. Matthew Payne says, some people join the Army not to go to school. NCOs don't need college to be a leader. Why force them? It's like no degree, no promotion. That's an interesting perspective.
I think they're listening to us. Education is important, whether it's PME or civilian education. Again, I hate to keep drawing back to the career maps, but that's something that we really talked about. And if we keep saying we want NCOs with education, college education, the proponencies put it in there, then that's something, that's another standard that they're going to have to work toward in the self-development domain using their tuition assistance and their experience in PME with ACE credit.
Okay, and we've got one for Sergeant Major Weber here, because they asked for you by name.
Oh, yes.
Oh, wow.
Is there any intent out there to combine existing personnel systems, EMILPO, EDAS, et cetera, and what impact would that have on personnel across the force?
Yes, there is a plan actually to combine those systems. What impact would it have? It'll be one type system so that all, you know, you can gather your information from one system versus kind of gathering from EDAS and EMILPO and those systems not talking to each other. So we're in the process of now developing a system called IPSE. And so you'll see that come online soon. Probably for some of you, it probably won't be soon enough. But there is a system out there to accomplish just that mission.
Well, I think that was a setup question because Sergeant Major Weber was inducted into the AG Hall of Fame last night. So I think that was a wise choice.
Excellent.
Roger, Sergeant. Cool.
Well, coming back to Facebook, Christina Guerrero Fryer, she's an E5 promotable, staff sergeant promotable, with 8 years in and getting ready to PCS. She wants to go to a career broadening assignment, but HRC keeps telling her that she needs to be an E6 with 2 years experience. Do you see changing the policy to allow E5s to become AIT instructors or even AIT platoon sergeants, just to name a few broadening opportunities?
Well, to talk about our Army rather than a specific case, you know, we think that non-commissioned officers are going to be in grade about 5 years. So the first 2 years, we want them, again, gaining experience in their core competencies, okay, and so then that gives us about 2 years to develop them through broadening opportunities, and then get them selected and get them ready for PME. So, without knowing specifically her issues or her having her ERB in front of me, I don't know. But I would tell you if she's not branch certified or done her 18 to 24 months in that next level job, that's what she should be focused on.
I would agree. I mean, you know, the thing is, when you get into the classroom as an instructor, you know, you're going to get troubleshot, and it's based upon experience. I mean, that's what they're looking for, is that NCO who's been out there as a squad leader, potentially deployed or otherwise, and had that experience. Now, I do encourage, especially on our side, on the Compo 3, I can't speak for the other components, that we do look at the opportunity that our E5s, as they're going out and getting that experience, so whether they're in the ONF land or in the generating force, is that we do provide them the opportunity to go ahead and get into ABIC or in the future IFSC and get them some of that training, get them a piece of that, so we're starting that early plateau of talent management to getting them in the right job at the right time.
And that's where I think a mentor actually comes in. Having a mentor is very important, so that you can sit down with your mentor and kind of discuss where you want to go as far as your career is concerned.
So
we got to just do more of that, ensuring that we get mentors so that they can help you guide your career.
Well, your mentor can give you the reality check.
Absolutely.
That's the other thing.
Yes.
If you were Sergeant E5 and you say, I want to go be a senior drill sergeant, chances are that person can say, tone it down a little. You got some ground to cover before you get that far.
Or more importantly, help them to get to that goal.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
If it's the ability of they want to be a drill sergeant and they're getting a minimum score on the APFT, hey, let's come up with a plan to improve your score, and then let's look at you becoming a drill sergeant.
Absolutely.
Not that you can't do it. Just work toward it.
Yes.
And if you look, you know, if I understood the question, she was an E5. But if you are a drill sergeant, you may be in charge of a platoon.
Yeah.
So it's the level of responsibility, you know, for the individual. And what we don't do in the Army, we don't put people out there to fail. And, you know, maybe she needs that extra experience to be successful.
Seasoning, that's the word
yes.
we're hearing a lot more of mm-hmm. these days.
Yes.
Broadening is important, but so is seasoning.
Mm-hmm. Right soldier, all right? Right skill set, right time.
Absolutely.
And right job.
Right time. Right job, right time, yeah.
So to switch gears a little bit, we haven't touched on the new NCOER, the new Noncommissioned Officer Evaluation Report. This upcoming Sergeant First Class Selection Board for both the active guard and reserve, will be the first centralized selection board that considers the new NCOER. And a question from Twitter from Anthony Buckheit. Sorry if I killed your name. How are senior NCO boards affected by the new NCOER and rater profiles. So what? How do we see those promotion boards being impacted by this new form?
Well, I don't know yet because we haven't experienced it. And we have the guidance out. We've done the training. We've begun writing the NCOERs. But what we don't know is how the board will interpret it, that writing. And so I think we'll learn a lot after this promotion board, and we'll be able to adjust ourselves and continue to be successful.
I'm very excited for this, though. We need to have a true evaluation tool. The previous NCOERs, I'm so old that I had an EER. And back then, the first EER I got was based on a 125-point system. There was the same categories we have now, but each one was worth 25 points. If you got a 123, you were done. So I, you know, as a teacher, I said, well, why don't we just have a three-point system then? Right? I mean, you're just overinflating this thing. If you don't get a 124 or 125, this whole system is not evaluative. So we've talked about this, and we talked about it in the Sergeant Major of the Army's Executive Council, and we came up. It has to be okay for you to, you know, think about a grade, A, B, C, D, F. It has to be okay to get a C. A C is a passing grade, and you want to get to the B. And maybe your first year, the first time you're evaluated as a staff sergeant, you're not as good as somebody that's been doing it for 2, 3, 4 years. Maybe you get a C your first year, and you say, okay, what do I need to do to get up here to a B and an A when it's time for me to be considered for promotion? If you don't get a true evaluation, you don't know what to improve on. All right, so I'm very excited about this. I think it's going to really give our boards the ammunition they need to make a true promotion OML.
Well, I'd like to pose a question to the panel, and I know all of us have enough time in service to have seen the culture in our officer corps that sometimes it can be a little cutthroat looking for that top block, that top evaluation. Do we foresee any similar developments in the NCO Corps where people now have to really work hard and compete for that top block?
Too early to tell.
But let's not call it cutthroat. Yeah. I mean, because the thing about it is, it's not, and I'll tell you my biggest concern about this is, I think that this can be a positive opportunity for the NCO Corps, unlike in the past. I've sat on numerous promotion boards, and unfortunately, we've probably, in times, we've promoted potentially the individual who wasn't necessarily best prepared for the position that we were promoting them toward, because all of the remarks were canned. They all look alike. What I am excited to see, though, is, and for soldiers to understand, is with the new evaluation, is you got to write what you mean and mean what you say, mm-hmm. and it's about having the ability to write. So I don't want to take away from your question, but I'm going to ask, because you know more about it, Dr. Butts, we talked about the online writing program today. Can you explain a little bit of that so we can throw that out there for our soldiers to be aware? Because one thing we've got to look across all three components is our folks got to improve their writing skills across the spectrum, and that's really going to impact us as we move forward under EES. So,
absolutely. Right, we came up with a writing assessment, and it's really done by Princeton University. I don't want to use the name, you know, of it. However, we are administering it at BLC right now. And the reason why we're doing it at BLC, because, you know, maybe at the master sergeant level or the sergeant major's level, it's too late for them to learn those skills. So we said what we do is start building from the bottom up, and it'll give us a chance, you know, to collect some data. And next year, you know, I think sergeant major, he said, okay, what we're going to do, we're going to go ALC, we're going to go SLC, ALC, SLC, and MLC all at once. And right now, it's been some real promising data. But really, what was really surprising to me, it was the Guard and the Reserve, they are scoring higher on the tests than anyone else. But more importantly, and looking at the scores, it's scored by a computer. So that way, all the doubts are removed from the scoring, because it's a computerized program that looks at everything and comes out with a score from a score of 1 to 6.
You know, I'm really excited about the new NCOR because I think it forces leaders to really sit down with soldiers and counsel soldiers, and so you know exactly where you stand. So I'm excited to see how the new NCOR and how it's going to affect soldiers. But it gives you that opportunity, that one-on-one opportunity to sit down with your leader, and so that he can or she can tell you, you know, what they're doing or what they're not doing, and how to get to wherever they need to get.
I'd like to talk about the writing real quick too. It probably shouldn't surprise you that the Guard and Reserve are scoring pretty well on that. It's because at the BLC level, we have the number two reason that soldiers join the Guard and Reserve is for education benefits. Mm-hmm. So we have a high percentage of soldiers that are current with their writing skills because they've been practicing and doing those things. I think the program that you said, that is, there's a writing assessment that allows a soldier that hasn't been writing as much the opportunity to improve, those will balance out. I think it's not that they're better. I think it's just they're more current with their skill set.
Well, and the power of this assessment Dr. Butts is talking about is after you complete it, it prints out what you need to work on. Is it grammar? Is it spelling? Is it sentence structure? And it gives you some tips of how to improve. And one of the things that we're talking about doing is putting some things online at the soldier's discretion to go in and actually work on it in the self-development domain, and then check the progress over time as they attend ALC and SLC. Mm-hmm. And it will, what we believe that we will see is that the writing will improve over time.
Okay. Well, we're going to take another brief break here, get some more water and stretch our legs. We want you to stick with us. Continue to post questions on the chat board, on our Facebook page, and through Twitter. Remember, use that hashtag #talktotradoc. That's the number two, talk to TRADOC. And we will come back with some more great questions, continue the conversation. We're going to ask one more time about training with industry programs for the Guard and Reserve. So that's coming up right after this. Hey, welcome back. We're here to continue the discussion with this great panel, and we're going to jump right into it. We have a question from Anonymous. Hopefully that's not the hacker group Anonymous. But Anonymous wants to know, what's up with this digital job book? Sergeant Major, what's the digital job book? Tell us all about it.
Well, you know, Sergeant Major Conley has done a fantastic job of taking us back in history when we had the EERs. And so I just want to build upon that with the job book that we used to carry. And the job book was a small, probably 1.5 by 3 inch, book that had our individual critical tasks in there. And when non-commissioned officers had provided opportunity training, or you finished with a collective event, you initialed it and you carried it in your upper left-hand pocket. So Sergeant Major was out running around, he would ask, what are you training on? And then the leaders would take that book to training meetings and plan training for our soldiers. So a very similar concept. The digital job book by proponent, lists the individual critical tasks that soldiers need to be proficient on by skill level. And it allows leaders to record that training. What's powerful about it is that it also allows chains of command to come in and insert tasks that they want to work on as well. So it's meeting the intent of the proponent, it's meeting the intent of the organization, and it's fed as an exchange of data between the digital job book and DTMS. I am proud to announce that the beta version of this will be out the 25th of March, and it'll be located on ATN, Army Training Network. So we want you to download it, manipulate it, move it around, put some data in there, and give us feedback before we go final.
This is a very important thing for squad leaders. This is extremely important because squad leaders can, all right, soldiers, pull out your job book. Let's look at what we've done and what we haven't done lately. Hey, we haven't done this for a while. Okay, we're going to get this into the training schedule and make sure that I train my squad on these tasks that we haven't touched for a while. So squad leaders, you got to be all over this. You got to jump in, get in the beta test whenever you can, start annotating the training that your soldiers have done, and then, like Sergeant Major Butt said, we got to get back to a training mentality with our first line leaders. Mm-hmm.
And one of the earlier questions was more time in the institutional training. Well, this digital job book will allow us to record mandatory training. So we don't necessarily have to teach it inside of the PME. We can do a check on learning, work it into scenarios, and partner with the organization or operational domain to do that training for us to free up contact hours to do other things.
Yeah, and what's great about it as well is that it follows you. So it just that won't stop at one unit. It goes on with you. So that's what's great about it.
So is this a program that's in pilot? So will this go to units and like full-size, you know, company, battalion, squadrons? Is that our way ahead with this?
Yeah, exactly. And, again, we want to get the beta version out there early so that we can work through the bugs and the kinks to make sure it's a quality product that soldiers will want to use and our non-commissioned officers will use as well.
If you look at BLC, 19 of the hours was mandatory training out of the 80. So just think if we could strip out the mandatory training, have a way to track it, and that was the intent when Sergeant Major Davenport came on board. That's what he wanted to do, to make sure that we clean up SSD, but we could account for the mandatory training.
And the last thing, it's always I didn't know I was going to school. And the digital job book receives a direct feed from ATARS into it. So not only does the soldier know, but when you build a hierarchy of job books, that squad leader will know as well.
Right on. Well, let's take it back to the chat board. The 16th Cav Squadron has a question. Why is the joint school transcript not being accepted by a Division I school? Will accreditation enable soldiers to get credit at higher quality colleges? Dr. Butts, I think that's a one that falls right into your court there.
Right, and Army University, what they're doing, they're meeting with different universities, and hopefully, at the end, that regardless what college is, they will be able to accept the educational requirements that the Army University has outlined by making sure that they have did an analytical look at the course, what the soldier has done, and it's accepted by all universities.
Well, and if just to jump on that, of course, the JST and eventually the Army U Universal Transcript, if you want to get the biggest bang for the buck right now, is, of course, taking advantage of the College of the American Soldier. There are Division I schools a part of that program, and if you want the maximum credit for your experience and your education that you received in the military, and you want the minimum amount of residency requirements, you should be directed toward College of the American Soldier.
Okay. We're going to reach back out to Facebook now. Felicia Red is asking a question about battalion and brigade command sergeant major positions. She says that those CSM positions in training brigades, certain training brigades, are coded 11 Zulu or infantry. Why aren't these positions MOS immaterial?
Well, it goes to the mission of the organization, and that's something that as we integrate our combat MOSs over time, we will grow into it. I don't know if we'll grow some female Zulus. I don't know if her point is do we relook at the coding or the MTO? I think that if that's a concern, well, we can have the IMT to do that.
Yeah, so as an example, 2nd Battalion, 13th Infantry Regiment, Fort Jackson. Mm-hmm. That's a basic training unit with an integrated POI that is an infantry-coded position. So should each of those positions be open to the
But it also goes back to the health of the CMF. That position is there for a reason. It's just not arbitrarily put out there. So if they're looking at long-term growth of their 11 Zulu population, then that might be a needed position.
Ah, I see. Okay. Well, we've got in the category of asked and answered, we have a question here from guest 8943. Is the training with industry program available for National Guard and Reserve soldiers as a broadening assignment? And the conventional wisdom was that
in certain circumstances it is, but it's something you have to ask in the National Guard, deal directly with your state, and in the Army Reserve at the reserve level, correct?
Well, yeah, so depending on the grade and the rank, you know, the opportunities are out there. We, again, we have made partnerships with different organizations. And then, of course, for a fellowship, as we've recently broadened the horizon for TPU soldiers now to be able to apply for a fellowship, we make those announcements, and then the packets come up, and then we board those at our level and then on up to the SMA's office. And of course, the USASMA will look at the fellowship packets and board those.
And I got another question from Facebook, and this ties directly to this. Humberto Becerra Jr. says, will the Training with Industry program at Caterpillar and Oshkosh be available to Guard and Reserve or AGR soldiers as a broadening assignment? So I guess what it comes down to is there a list out there that someone can go and look for to say, I qualify for this, this is available to me?
Yes, so there are. And again, you know, I think it's probably too early to say who all is going to partner with us from the industry standpoint. I don't know if Oshkosh and Caterpillar have. You guys will maybe know that better from the AC
Well, person. We do have, and I believe it's in the 88 Mike CMF. So there is an opportunity out there. And if that's necessary and a Guard soldier would like to do that, again, it's about working through the chain of command, getting the packet up, getting up to HRC, and allow the Special Actions Branch to take a look at it.
And one thing we have to be careful of is the utilization of the soldier once they return back from their training. Because we send them to this great training, then we'll bring them back. But maybe they need to go to the institution to share the knowledge of what they learned.
And it's a great point that you remind me of, Dr. Butts. That's exactly right. So we have to start thinking through a part of talent management and the work we're doing with HRC and the enlisted cohort. So we have to think through, all right, we're going to send Davenport to do this work at Caterpillar. What's the follow-on assignment? So we really have to be thinking a move ahead so that we don't waste that valuable opportunity.
Well, we're going to go back to the chat board. One of my favorite sergeant majors in the Army, they're in Okinawa, Japan, asking, what are the chances of soldiers receiving credit for attending Air Force NCO Academy? Dr. Butts.
And I'm going to turn this one over to Sergeant Major Davenport because, I mean, I have really got the scar tissue on this one, but I think he has a good answer.
The force of this, that. Right now, what we want to talk about is our PME and the importance of getting our soldiers to our schools that we have seats to get them certified in their core competencies. So that they can get promoted. I do think that in the future there could be an opportunity for us to do an exchange of allowing non-commissioned officers that exceed standards to have this opportunity. It's really a broadening opportunity, you think about it. Just another way of highlighting the great NCO Corps that we have that General Perkins talked about. So, but would that be in lieu of our PME? I don't think so.
That's a hard bridge to cross right there. Now, do we have exchange programs at the senior enlisted level
right,
where you can get sister service? Is that correct?
So we have other services attending Sergeant Major Academy. We actually have an Air Force non-commissioned officer attending this pilot of the Master Leader course. So we do exchange within in services. But again, I'm talking about certifying on core competencies of a particular CML.
Sure.
That must reside into our model. And then providing a broadened opportunity for others to go and to attend something like that in the Air Force Academy. I do think that we have some billets that haven't been filled in a while as instructors. And what I have asked HRC is to kindly figure out how many they are and if they're still, is it still feasible that we can fill it and sustain it over time?
Well, sustaining or ensuring core competencies are trained is a great bullet point because that's coming straight from Facebook. What are the chances of bringing back the skills qualification test?
Now, I'm far too young to remember the SQT, as I'm sure everyone at this table is. Far too young to remember the SQT. The SQT was an excellent tool to keep soldiers on their core competencies and to keep soldiers on their toes to make sure they were tracking the skills that they needed to have at that particular skill level. Is that anywhere in the future for us?
Yeah, so quite honestly, we have begun some work looking at this, and I hear this quite often as I travel around as well. But we have to really understand SQT. SQT was the written test, and the hands-on portion was the CTT test. And so there was a hands-on, and then there was a academic check on learning. And so then when we removed CTT, we went to an SDT, SDT, skills development test, I think it was what it was called. And really, when soldiers failed that, what was the repercussion? And so there was no bite behind the bark. So, and then the manpower and the costs associated with that program, it just didn't have the biggest bang for the buck. And really, the certification of soldiers, their core competency should be at the within the organizations to prepare them to come into the institutional domain.
And I did a financial analysis on it, and if you look at how much it would cost just to create all the tests, and because he had me to do it, and and my God, I mean, I was shocked. I mean, because it costs in the hundreds of millions of dollars just to sustain it each year.
And in an era of budgetary constraints, that bird ain't flying.
Well, I don't know. So I think the Army's willing to invest. We have to figure out how we get the biggest bang for the resources that we have. If it really doesn't have any value or contribute to strengthen the core or becomes a bureaucratic process, I think there's better ways, more efficient ways of making sure our noncommissioned officers are ready to do their job.
Well, I think this has been a great conversation so far. Thank you for coming, and it's about that time, Sergeant Major. About that time. Well, this concludes the Army's first State of NCO Development Town Hall. Before I turn it over to Sergeant Major Davenport for final remarks, I just want to allow the panel a few minutes just to give their final thoughts. We're going to go first to Sergeant Major Wills.
So, Sergeant Major Davenport, I just want to make sure that we get it out across the air there that our soldiers they need to realize that they're in good hands, that they understand that we are truly a one Army component today working together. As the Chief of Staff of the Army talks about, there's 980,000 of us as opposed to 450,000. And I really appreciate the fact that you and TRADOC are looking after our components just like we are the active component. And that our soldiers need to understand that that there's great things on the horizon for what TRADOC is working toward, and we appreciate your support.
Now we're going to throw it over to Command Sergeant Major Conley.
Thank you. Command Sergeant Major Davenport and esteemed panel members, thank you for giving us this opportunity to participate tonight. I think it was well worth our time to listen to our most important customers, which is our junior soldiers and our mid-grade NCOs, as they try to wade their way through the changes that are coming and become informed. And I really appreciate all of you for participating tonight. That shows great strength of character and your willingness to try to move the Army forward. I appreciate y'all being here. And I do want to echo what Sergeant Major Will said. We are full partners in this. There is nothing that Sergeant Major Davenport does in TRADOC that he does not consult with Sergeant Major Wills and I to make sure that we are coming up with a total Army solution, along with the SMA, all right, and all the senior NCOs across the Army. But Sergeant Major Davenport, you've been a true battle buddy, and I appreciate everything you've done, and I'm honored to be sitting here tonight with this team trying to help our soldiers become better in their careers.
Great. Thanks, Sergeant Major Conley. We're going to move now to Sergeant Major Weber.
Sergeant Major Davenport, I'd like to thank you as well for including me on the panel. I'd just like to say to soldiers, thanks for also for bringing us your questions, your concern. Now you can see that TRADOC really listens. I ask that also that, you know, I read somewhere today, it talks to the NCO non-professional, the NCO guide that states that every soldier has a sergeant, and every sergeant has a leader. And a leader's responsibility is to ensure that soldiers are the welfare of a soldier, and then also development of a soldier. You know, and TRADOC has that responsibility of developing our soldiers. It's all about professional development. I ask that you embrace the changes. You know, don't knock it without trying. TRADOC has done some great things for our soldiers, and it's about the next generation of soldiers, next generation of developing the next generations of leaders. So each generation has a responsibility to ensure that our soldiers are developed.
Great. Thank you, Sergeant Major Weber. And now to Dr. Butts.
Well, I would like to thank Sergeant Major Davenport. You will often hear him say, no one cares about the soldier more than he does, and he only has a limited amount of time to get things done. So his resources are put into the research to make sure that we're making the right decisions. And for him, you know, we have probably moved the ball farther in the last year than we have, you know, in the last, you know, probably 40-something years. So, you know, Sergeant Major, I just want to thank you for your dedication to the American soldier.
And Sergeant Major, the floor is yours.
Well, I don't know how to follow that, but it's not about me. It's about the team. And each and every one of you tuning in, wherever you're at around the world, hopefully this has had value to you all. I know this. We didn't get to everything that that you wanted to talk about, but I assure you that we will continue to monitor the chat boards and Facebook, and I'll jump back there and start answering some myself. But don't let the dialogue end today. There's a great opportunity for you to keep up with what's going on by logging on to TRADOC News, all one word.org, and follow the blog site where I talk about the changes that are occurring in non-commissioned officer professional development. Now, for all you non-commissioned officers and leaders out there, I really need to make sure that you download the NCO 2020 strategy. Read it and understand it. And I think if you do that for me, you will understand the three line of efforts that we're working on. That's the development of the non-commissioned officer, how to talent manage that non-commissioned officer, and how we remain stewards of this great profession and take care of our Army that we so deeply care about. And then underneath there, you will see the subtasks. And there's probably about three orders that you need to know about. And that is the base order to NCOPDS, FRAGO 1, and the soon-to-be-released FRAGO 2. And if you read strategy, you see the base order, you see how the fragos are coming out, you will understand how all this is nested together, not only with our Army, but with each of the components that's represented here at the table. So I appreciate your time, I appreciate what you do, and I look forward to hearing from you as I travel around.
All right. Well, thank you, Sergeant Major. And while this ends the panel discussion, this does not end the conversation. Continue to use that hashtag #TalkToTRADOC, that's the number 2, #TalkToTRADOC, and post it through social media sites, Facebook and Twitter, and through TRADOCnews.org, you might see some of the answers to the questions you're asking. Just want to let you know that the video of tonight's discussion will be posted to TRADOC's YouTube channel and social media sites tomorrow. So please make sure to share them with your aspiring NCOs and your NCOs who may have missed tonight's event. Also, let us know what you thought about this. Was it helpful and informative? Could we do something better? Please let us know, because we just added a post to Facebook asking for your feedback. Jump in there and comment. There's also a link to a survey. If you could take that survey, we'd appreciate it. Like I said, the end of the panel, but not the end of the conversation. Thanks for joining us.